हेलो एवरीवन, द टॉपिक ऑफ माय रिसर्च पेपर इज रूरल माइग्रेशन कल्चर एंड द सिटी लॉस्ट अपॉर्चुनिटी इन कठपुतली कॉलोनी। कठपुतली कॉलोनी सेटलमेंट लोकेटेड इन द वेस्ट दिल्ली जोन एंड द नेम ऑफ द प्रेजेंट ड्राइव फ्रॉम द ट्रेडिशनल राजस्थानी आर्ट ऑफ पपेट्री। इट इज़ अराउंड 60 ईयर्स ओल्ड सेटलमेंट एंड द रेजिडेंट्स ऑफ द एरिया who were settled here came from different parts of rural India. In the present scenario, it is a prime site situated along with the two major transportation hubs that are Shadipur bus depot and the another one is Shadipur metro station. Because of that, land prices in the area increased. Even that's the main reason for the increase in FAR to maximize profits. Now, Delhi Development Authority hand over this first pilot in situ rehabilitation project to Raheja Developer under the Public-Private Partnership Model Scheme for the redevelopment of the area. The aim of the research work is to find an optimum solution for rehousing populations living in the shanty settlements called slums in the metropolitan cities. Objectives of the research work are to understand the gaps in current government policies for the rehabilitation of informal settlements. Second one is to explore various researches related to social housing in all over the world. And the third one is to develop an approach for the overall improvement of built environment of the metropolis. Methodology adopted for this research work is primary data basically collected with the help of practicing architects, NGOs, researchers, community leaders and representatives interviews. And the secondary data were collected from books, articles and reports. There are various studies and proposals for the improvement of Kathputli colony development were made in the last 50 years. The first proposal was given by architect Repti Kamath. She documented 500 household units in 1970s that show beautiful vernacular forms built in mud, bamboo and thatch, reflected the rural origins and nomadic history of the migrants. She has studied their socio-economic environment and even the aspirations of the community are well documented. These close interactions with the community lead to her redesign of their unauthorized settlement. She named the settlement Anandgram and her attempts to fuse the architecture with the collective consciousness of the dwellers are commendable. In 1980s, city authorities were changed their perspectives towards the redevelopment of informal settlements. On this basis, a second proposal for the development of settlement was given by Anil Lal. He designed a duplex type of housing cluster. By the 1990s, the urban policy changed and city authorities were rehousing the slum dwellers in apartments on the fringe of the city. In 1996, he drafted another proposal for the resettlement of the community in the Mehroli area. But surprisingly, both proposals were rejected by the community. In 2002, the Delhi Development Authority allotted them Janta flats in Dwarka area. But again, community refused the proposal due to relocation. Fourth proposal was given by Raheja Developer for the rehousing of slum dwellers in situ in high-rise apartments, operated and maintained by developers for next 15 years in return for economic benefits given by the government in terms of land, its commercial use and tax incentives are currently understood as the optimum solution. This appointment of a developer by the local authority for an upgradation of a slum is called the PPP model, that is public-private partnership. In 2016, Kathputli colony was documented by the author to understand the existing complexities of such shanty settlements in the urban metropolises. Surveys and interviews of residents showed that their houses are not only places of living but also places for working. Observations confirm this by revealing a wide range of house forms and clusters based on the different income generation activities taking place and the network among them. Above settlement maps and sketches of the houses showed the indigenous character of built form evolved on the basis of socio-culture networks and occupational needs. Although the existing houses are constructed with mud bricks and roofs with corrugated sheet, plastic or any cheap material, this is subject to improvement in the family income. I referred three different studies to form an approach for the designing of housing for the rehabilitation of the informal settlements. First case study is Defensible Spaces, given by Oscar Newman, in which he talked about different type of buildings. First category is detached houses, second one is walk-up apartments, third one is high-rise apartments. He talked about different buildings types create different spaces inside and outside of the dwellings that affects the resident's life. A study given by Oscar Newman continues to hold good for understanding the social dimension of housing typology. He explained how building height can change the connection between the building with the surroundings. Next case study is Utopia on Trial, given by Ellis Coleman. Ellis Coleman talked about various design issues in the large-scale high-density housing, like size variables. It is associated with these spaces and included the height and size of blocks and the number of dwellings served by each entrance. So for that, Coleman uses a term, confused spaces, to refer to those spaces that have a lack of territorial definition and no responsibility for spaces around dwellings. Second point is surveillance. The issue of entrance characteristics, circulation variables, included overhead walkways, interconnected exits, vertical routes and long access corridors, and desk raises a problem of surveillance. Third one is escape routes. It's about housing layout, create a multiple access and exit points in a housing area, making areas more vulnerable to crime by providing escape routes for criminals. And the third study is given by Shirish Patel, that is urban layout densities and the quality of life. Shirish Patel talked about different spaces like public, private and arterial transportation spaces that are required for the improvement of both the physical as well as social environment in an urban area, because it will provide healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. He defines six different parameters also, like public ground area, built-up area, floor space index, buildable plot ratio, net density and gross density. These six parameters are required for the designing of any urban layout. Conclusive arguments against the high-rise apartment typology for economically weaker sections. In the left-hand side graph, Oscar Newman have emphasized the relationship between the increase in crime and increased building height, and that crime is mostly located within the public areas. When we increase the height of the building, so we increase the number of public spaces within the building and surrounding. Due to lack of territorial definition, no responsibility for spaces around the building, these spaces become more prone towards crime. High-rise development requires surveillance and high maintenance of the public spaces, otherwise these spaces become more vulnerable to crime. On the other hand, Ellis Coleman's research has shown that high-rise development creates design disadvantages in public housing scenarios. Complex circulation pattern, multiple access and exit routes, lack of territorial definition, no responsibility for spaces around the dwellings, and confused spaces are identified as source of problem like crime, vandalism, and breakdown of civilized behavior. In the right-hand side diagram, I am trying to show PGA, means public ground area, is an important indicator of the condition of open spaces. BUA, means built-up area per capita, is an indicator of living condition. FSI, means floor space index, means when we higher the FSI, means we raise the density. BPR is an indicator of crowding. So, as we already know that in Indian cities, we have inadequate infrastructure facilities, and on the other hand, insufficient supply of electricity and water. If we raise FSI in the over-congested settlements, we will put tremendous effects on the immediate surrounding neighborhood areas, because it will turn over use of roads, footpaths, hospitals, and other amenities. I am trying to show when we increase FSI during the redevelopment of overcrowding settlements and decrease public ground area as well as built up area per capita, then it will degrade the quality of life. In the Indian scenario, government agencies are talking about built up and carpet area only. But where is public ground area for basic infrastructure, amenities and recreational facilities for the well-being of society? As a designer or planner, it's our responsibility to understand the existing living style and economic base of the community, which we should consider for the future development of the informal settlements. The upcoming in-situ rehabilitation projects should support the socio-physical aspirations of the community, and the newly built form should provide them a sense of belonging and equitable distribution of all essential amenities and utilities for the progressive change and growth of the community. I gave few of the recommendations for the better development of Kathputhli Colony are: first one is compact and low-rise built form. It will support their lifestyle and working conditions. Living closer to the ground means more interaction and monitoring of the surroundings. Hierarchy of open spaces. Instead of large green open space, small open spaces are distributed throughout the settlement, taking in consideration the traditional living pattern and easy to maintain also for them. By providing them basic urban level infrastructure requirement like water and electricity supply, health and education facilities. Even through skill development programs and startups for business, we can improve industrial based occupation for the community. Thank you.